Okay, then let's continue. So you can reach the lab manual from OptiClass. I uploaded it yesterday. So this week's lab is about hypothesis testing, specifically analyzing proportion. So in previous week, you have seen how to do hypothesis testing, and it was in the context of binomial test. Actually, you are not specifically told about that specific test and Poisson test. But today we are going to be only working in binomial cases when we have categorical data. Let me show it to you here. When you have a categorical data and when you have two outcomes, then we can analyze its proportion using binomial distribution. So let's quickly remember how we do hypothesis testing from previous week. Let me show here. I think I think I can share you with I can share with you the lab manual in the webinar, but it's okay. You can also open it from OptiClass. Just a second. Okay, remember in hypothesis testing, first we need to state our hypothesis. We have a null hypothesis and an alternative hypothesis. And null hypothesis will be always about the things we will be testing. So we are not going to do anything about alternative hypothesis. We are always testing hypothesis with our sample. So if we reject the null hypothesis, then our sample will favor the alternative hypothesis. And to test the null hypothesis, we need a null distribution. And in the previous week, you were given the null distribution using a sampling distribution. Actually, you can test the null hypothesis both using sampling distribution, taking many, many random samples from your population. So in this case, we were simulating this with sample function, if you remember, and then constructing the null distribution and testing our sample using this null distribution. Okay, and this week we are going to do the same hypothesis testing using a theoretical distribution. But for this, the assumptions of the theoretical distribution must be held. So in the binomial case, so you need to have two categorical data, the sampling should be random, etc. The test we are going to use is the binom.test function. So since I think I can't share you with the lab manual, I will show it to you here in our studio. Okay, maybe let me if I will stop screen sharing, and I also want to share with you the lab manual. Let me just quickly try to do it. Okay, now you can see our studio, right? And now I think we can also see the log menu. Okay, that's better. Okay, we are going to use this binom.test function, and the arguments of it will be the first argument is the number of success, the second argument is the number of trials, your sample size, and the p argument is the hypothesized probability of success. So this will be your null hypothesis. If you are doing a one-sided test, you can specify the alternative hypothesis here in this argument. By default, it is two-sided, so if you are doing a two-sided test, you don't need to specify alternative hypothesis. It is by default two-sided. And there is another argument called confidence level, so you can specify your confidence level. We will come to this part later. So I want to start with the thought example from previous week. Let me also show it to you here. Okay, I think I can't do anything about this voice issues. I will try to speak louder. Is it okay now? Can you hear and understand me? Okay, so this is my upload speed is not that much high, so sometimes it might get it might freeze sometimes, but if it continues for a long time and if you can't understand me, please write that. Write it in the chat so we can wait for a couple of seconds and hope it to go. Yes, Khan, by default, the binom test will give you a two-sided test. So let's do one quick example, this right and left-handed thoughts. Yes, I think sometimes because of the connection, my voice might get worse. So if you see that happen, please write that in the chat so I can repeat again that part that you couldn't hear me. Okay, let's continue then. So in previous weeks, we had an example about right and left-handed thoughts. And we have we did the hypothesis testing using sampling distribution let me show it from here. We were taking random samples with the same sample size from right and left-handed thoughts, and we constructed a null distribution and then tested whether our observation is very unlikely given that null distribution. So using for loop, we were constructing a null distribution. So actually, just a second. Actually, there is a very simple way of doing that, this test. So if you remember that there were 18 thoughts and 14 of them were right-handed. And the question was if there is a handedness in the thoughts. So and remember that this is a two-sided test. So if we were asking if the question is the thoughts are right-handed, then we would have done a one-sided test. But now we are testing whether there is a handedness in both directions, left or right. So then we must do a two-sided test. So we can do this by just using this binom.test, and our observation is 14. We have seen 14 right-handed thoughts, and our sample size is 18. And then our p-value, so P here is means that it is the proportion of right-handed thoughts, which is our null hypothesis. So if the question is whether the thoughts have handedness, so the proportion of thoughts, is it 0.5 or not? So this is our null hypothesis. Then we should specify P as 0.05. And as I said before, we don't need to specify the alternative hypothesis, but let's do it anyway for the sake of illustration. And you should write two-sided here with dots. So how would you know that this is dots? Of course, you could just go to the help page of the binomial test, and you see here that three options, two-sided, less, and greater. And confidence level by default 95%, so it will give us 95% confidence interval. So let's do the test. Okay, it says the exact binomial test, and our data is 14 and 18. 14 is observation, 14 is the number of success, 18 is the number of trials, and this is the p-value. So if our alpha is 0.05, since our p-value is smaller than that, then we reject the null hypothesis, right? And this is the 95% confidence interval. And remember that we can reach the same conclusion either using p-value or 95 or confidence interval. So you see that this 95% confidence interval does not contain our null hypothesis, proportion of right-handed thoughts being 0.05. So this range does not contain 0.5. Then you reject the null hypothesis. So very easy, right? That part is clear. So let's compare this with our previous week's results, whether we have consistent results here. So let me show it to you here. Okay, I will make this bigger. So remember, we were summing the observations in both extreme cases in both directions, and we were summing this part and this part, and our result was 0.05, then in total we have our probability is 0.033. And we reject the null hypothesis, right, using sampling distribution. And here also, using the theoretical distribution, the binomial distribution, we almost get same p-value, which is not surprise, of course. So how does this binomial test function calculate this p-value? So let me also illustrate this. Okay, if you don't have this course, I think I can share with you the manual. I don't know if I can do it now. Okay, let me try to do it quickly. Just a second. Okay, I shared with you this manual, but my screen sharing is now gone. Okay, sorry, let me Okay, Etika will put the drive link to that lab manual. I think he can do it now. Then he will put the link here and you can reach the manual. Okay, thank you. No, okay, the Etika will do it for us. Okay, where were we? Okay, I was going to show you how this binom.test function calculates that p-value. So our sample size is 18, right? And from, you know, in previous weeks, we could use this dbinom function to calculate the probability of each outcome. So we have, if our sample size is 18, we have, we can have zero right-handed thoughts, one right-handed thoughts, two right-handed thoughts, etc., and up to 18 right-handed thoughts. Yes, Yetkin has answered that. Thank you. So probability of success here is 14 divided by 18. Can you hear me now? Hello? Hello? I will, okay, now you can hear me, right? Okay. Okay, thank you. Now let's continue. So you could calculate probability of each outcome using either that formula that you have learned already in high school, or you could use this dbinom function. And remember that dbinom function, you could give a vector of vector with each outcome, and then it will calculate the probability for each of them. So as I said before, we could have from 0 to 18 right-handed thoughts, right? And so these are all possible outcomes. And then, okay, let me, so this is X, and our size is 18. We have 18 thoughts in total. And probability is 0.5. Right now, this dbinom function will give us the probability of observing each outcome. So this is the probability of observing zero right-handed thoughts if the probability, if the population has p 50% of the population has have right-handed and 50% have left-handed thoughts. And since we have 18 thoughts, you can multiply these outcomes with 18, and this will be your expected frequency. But we don't need to calculate this. If you plot this using bar plot, let me save this to X, or let me call it props, the probabilities for each outcome. And if you plot the bar plot of it, so since this is a categorical variable, we need to use the bar plot, right? And let me also add the names for, we have from 0 to 18. Etka has shared you with the material related to this week's and previous week's lab. Now you see that the probabilities for each outcome here is given in this bar plot. So what do we need? Since we observed 14 right-handed thoughts, and since we are doing a right-handed test, we should sum the probabilities from 14 up to 18. And since we have 5 probabilities here, 5 observations, so you should also sum on the left-hand side. So from 0 to 4, there is in total 5 observations. We can also color this. So let me try to do it. So what do we need? We need to let's color the parts that we need to sum. So from 0 to 4 and 14 to 18. So let's create a vector with 2 colors. And from this subset, so we can do like this. Step 5. In total, we have 19 outcomes, right? And then rep 2, 8, and rep 1, 5. Let me call this poll F. And then our color will be, so this will be a conditional coloring, right? We shouldn't take this 13, right? So this is wrong. What happened here? So since we have in total 19 and we are starting from 0, so this should be we have 9 twos, and now this is the correct one. And then we need to sum these probabilities and this part. And as you can see, since this is a theoretical distribution, it is perfectly symmetrical. The probabilities on the left-hand side are exactly the same probability on the right-hand side. But remember that from the previous week, if you are using sampling distribution, since there is a randomness in that, the probabilities will not be the same. Let me show it to you if I can find it. Here. So this is also symmetrical, but not perfectly, since we were using the sampling distribution, taking random samples. So we were individually summing the values on the left-hand side and the right-hand side. So the values will be similar, but will not be exactly the same. But here in theoretical distribution, it is perfectly symmetrical. And therefore, you can use one of the tails and then multiply it with 2 to get your p-value. So we have this props, right? And you see this first and last one are exactly the same, second and the second last one are exactly the same, etc. So how do we calculate the p-value? So from left hand side, from the first five observations, probabilities for those observations. And if you sum these values, right, and sum this with the left-hand side, right-hand side, from 14 to, so remember we have 19, right? So therefore, we should start from 15. And we get this p-value. So let's check whether this p-value is the same from the binom.test function. So p-value is 0.038888. So the same value. So you can either do this or you can just get one of the tails and multiply it with two, so you will get the same result. Okay, let's save this to and result of this binom test function to an object. And from this object, you can, using this dollar sign, you can get some various results. So statistics is the number of success, and our parameter is the number of tries, so we don't need that. Okay, this is the p-value. You can just extract the p-value from here, and also the confidence interval. And as I said before, since our confidence interval does not contain our null hypothesis, then you reject the null hypothesis. Null value, alternative, etc. You can get the all values here. Okay. Let's go back to the manual. Let me check whether if I missed something. Okay, you have learned, I think, in class two different confidence interval methods to calculate any confidence interval. The aggressive call method and Volt method, but neither of these methods is given in this binom.test function. So let's check the help page of it. And as you see, it states the confidence interval is obtained by a procedure given in Clotter and Pearson. So I've tested, and this confidence interval is a little bit wider than the other two methods given in your book. Okay, can you hear me now? Yeah, sometimes my internet connection slows down, in that time it might get slower, but is it okay now? Can you hear me clearly? If just someone write it in the chat, I will continue. No one? Okay, thank you. You can hear me clearly, right? Not perfectly, but okay. So anyway, you have learned, so let me show it from slides of your, from the book. So there are two methods to calculate confidence interval. One is the Volt method, and it uses the z value from normal distribution. So unfortunately, the binomial test function does not gives you those confidence intervals. So if you want to calculate confidence interval using Wolf method, you would just use this formula. And also for the ugliest call method, you should calculate the p prime, x is being your number of success, etc. So then you would use this formula to calculate confidence interval. So I am not going to do it here in our studio since it is trivial, right? So so it's just a quick calculation, but I suggest you to do this after class as an exercise, and you will see that these two methods will give you a narrower confidence interval than given here. And okay, so if you want to have a more stringent, the more precise narrow confidence interval, then you should use one of these two methods. So let's do one more example from this manual. Okay, it says in human genome there are 781 genes on X chromosome and 19,000 something genes on other chromosomes. And X chromosomes chromosome covers 5.2% of the whole genome. So this indicates that if genes are distributed evenly through the chromosomes and randomly, one should expect 5.2% of the genes to be located on the X chromosome. So then we need to test if this observed ratio is in accordance with the expected ratio. And since we don't indicate any direction, we need to do a two-sided test. So we are not asking if there is less proportion of genes than this value, or more proportion of genes from this value. Therefore, so we are not indicating any direction. Therefore, we need to do a two-sided test. Right? So what is our null and alternative hypothesis? So the, okay, let me write it here, the exercise one. Our null hypothesis is the proportion of genes in the X chromosome is 0.052, right? This was the 5.2%. And alternative hypothesis is P is not 0.052. Okay. Okay, use appropriate test for hypothesis test function. Okay, which test we should use? Okay, it is obvious that we will use a binomial test function, but if this question was given to you in a quiz or in an exam, how would you decide on binomial test? So again, we okay, you should decide, you should just look at your data. You know that, so we have two cases here, right? The genes being on X chromosome or genes not being on X chromosome. So we have only two outcomes. So since we have two outcomes, then the test should be a binomial test. Okay, then we are going to decide whether we should reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis, and then calculate the confidence interval. Okay, let's do that part. So we will use this binomial test function, and okay, we have what is our observation? We have 781 genes on X chromosome, so this is And in total, so 19,000 something genes on other chromosomes. So what is our N? So if you write this, this will be wrong, right? So this is the number of genes on other chromosomes, but you need to specify here the total number of genes. So 19,546 plus 781 will be our N sample size. And what will be our P, the proportion of genes? So it will be our null hypothesis. It is 0.052. Since we are doing a two-sided test, right, we don't need to specify anything more. So let me call it genes X. Okay, our p-value is highly significant, right? So 2.2 e minus 16 means that it is 2.2 times 10 to the minus 16. So e means power of 10 in our language. So this value is very, very small. Okay. So if you want to write this value explicitly, you can just make this very high, and then you will see 2.2 times 10 to the minus 16. I think there is at least 15 zeros here. Anyway, so this value is highly significant. So probability of success is 0.038, which is 781 divided by this value. And our 95% confidence interval is this, 0.035 up to 0.041. But you see that this confidence interval does not contain our null hypothesis, this value. Therefore, we reject the null hypothesis. Or we see that p-value is too small, therefore we reject the null hypothesis. Okay, what if you want to calculate the 99% confidence interval? It is again easy, right? Then we should just specify this value, confidence level. It is 0.99, and then it will give you the 99% confidence interval. And if you compare it, it goes from this so this is wider, right? So it is it makes sense because you want to make sure that your true proportion so 99% of the time you want to get the proportion to be in that range, therefore it should be wider. It will be wider. Okay, the last question here. Consider that someone hypothesis X chromosome should contain less number of genes, claiming that there are less sex-related genes. Using this information, perform a new hypothesis test followed by indicating null and alternative hypothesis. So if question becomes like this, then you should make your test one-sided, right? Because it says X chromosome by any way. So someone claimed that X chromosome should contain less number of genes. Then, okay, in that case, null hypothesis will be again the same, and our alternative hypothesis P is less than 0.052. So in that case, so without just running this code, what would you expect this p-value to be? It should be the half of this, right? Since we are now only summing one tail of the distribution. So of course, since p-value is very, very, very small, we can see the difference here. It's just pay attention here that p-value is smaller than this value. So when p-value is so small, it R does not give you the exact p-value. So this is the threshold. If it is lower than this, it will just report that p-value is smaller than this. So therefore, we get the same result. But normally, when you make a one-sided test, it will just, your p-value should be half of the p-value from two-sided test. Okay, yes, in the first one, by default, it is 5%. And if you specify any other confidence interval, it will calculate that for you. So if you want to calculate 70% confidence interval, it will give you 70% confidence interval. So, or 995. So this corresponds to the alpha being 0.005, right? This one. So in that case, this will be wider. Okay, let's also solve this exercise question. Okay, it says you want to cultivate oranges, and before making a big investment, you want to test the survival rate of orange seedlings with a small sample. So you buy 20 seedlings, and the producer tells you that at least 80% of those products will survive to next year. So you plant those seedlings, and you get 14 of your seedlings alive. So we are going to test whether the producer is telling us the truth or he's a liar. Okay, and okay, the question is, would you say that producer is wrong and less than 80% of the product survive to the next year? So here we need to do a one-sided test, right? Because he or she says that at least 80% of the products survive to the next year. So at alpha level 0.05, we will make the hypothesis, right? Okay, what is our population? Population is the number of seedlings. The producer has, right? The seedlings, all of the seedlings the producer have, not the 20. So this is our sample. So sample and sample size. The sample is the 20 seedlings that we bought, and sample size is 20. And our test statistic is this 14, the number of surviving seedlings, and we will do hypothesis testing. Now, what is our null hypothesis? So it is the probability for a given seedling to survive, right? So it is 8% or 0.8 or more. So you can actually sometimes the null hypothesis, if it is one-sided, null hypothesis can be written like this in previous example. So I think that part is not much important, but let's do it that way. So null hypothesis is What was it? 8%, right? 8% or greater, and our alternative is P is less than 0.8. So let me just write the exercise one. Please. Okay. And then okay, next question. Sorry, I lost. Okay, it is here. So out of 20 siblings, we have 14 surviving. So our x is 14, our sample size is 20, and our p is 0.8. And you need to specify the alternative hypothesis. Being less, so our null hypothesis is 0.8% or more, so our alternative therefore should be less. Okay, but we are testing the null hypothesis. The producer tells you at least 8% of the product survive to the next year. So this is the, so in the population of siblings, we expect to, the producer tells you to, tells you that at least 80% will survive. We are going to test this one, the 8%. So this is our null hypothesis, null distribution. And we are going to, we will try to, falsify this, right? Given our sample. So if our sample supports this, then it is okay. He doesn't tell you, he tells you the truth. But if you reject the null hypothesis, then you would say that this sample that you have doesn't support that null hypothesis. Yes, therefore this is producer's claim will be our null hypothesis. Okay, the p-value is 0.20, so this is very high. Then given this sample, given this observation, our results doesn't conflict with the null hypothesis, therefore we fail to reject it. The producer doesn't seem to lying to us. Okay, this part is clear, right? Because you need to know how to construct the null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. Otherwise, so it is very easy to write those parts, right? No problem in that, but if you construct null and alternative hypothesis wrong, then your p-value will be wrong and your conclusion will be wrong. Okay, your claim is that he's a liar. No, since our p-value is high, so if our alpha is 0.05, our p-value is higher than that, then we fail to reject the null hypothesis. So what was the claim? Producer tells you that at least 8% of the products will survive. So our sample, our data doesn't conflict with this result. So therefore, he's not a liar, our conclusion. Okay. So if conclusion, okay, if the producer had not made any claim about survival rate, and we want to get an estimate for survival rate of ORIT siblings based on our sample, we can get a confidence interval for that. Okay, maybe we can make this distinction. Normally, we use the p-value to make hypothesis testing. Of course, you can to reject or not to reject the null hypothesis. But of course, you can use the same you can use the confidence interval to reach the same conclusion. But p-value is more practical and easier to comment on it. But if you are not doing a hypothesis testing, if you are not making any claim about survival rate, and if you want to make an estimate of a population using your sample, then confidence interval will be very useful for that. So what is our 95% confidence interval? It is already given here. So the true population parameter is in between this range, but if it is, if we didn't make any claims. So if we didn't make any claims about survival proportion being higher or less than 8%, then you shouldn't specify alternative hypothesis or make it two-sided. And then, sorry. And then our confidence interval is between 0.45 and 88. So the true population parameters, the survival proportion of seedlings, is between this range. Of course, this is very wide, right? It goes up to 88%, and it could be anywhere between this between this range, between these two values. So if we need a more precise, narrower interval, what can we change? So think about this for a minute. Well, you can decrease your confidence level, right? Then it will be narrower. Or you can increase your sample size. Okay, there is one more example. So this example is very similar to the first one. Maybe we, there was another example. Okay, let me try to find it. Okay, I think I didn't upload the newer version. We can solve one more example and then we can finish or take your question. So I put this question from the book. So it is from assignment problem 21 from chapter 7. From the analyzing proportions chapter. So again, this one is easy. Let's do one more quick example. So it says in a test of Murphy's law, pieces of toast were buttered on one side and then dropped. Murphy's law predicts that they will butter side down. So you know this joke, right? So out of 9,981 total slices of toast dropped, 6,101 landed butter side down. Okay, what a waste of toast, right? So it says what is the 95% confidence interval for the probability of a piece of toast landing butter side down. So what was our observation? 6101. So in total, we have 98-21. And P is 0.5, right? So if there is no effect of putting butter on the bread, so it can land either side with equal probability. And this is our 95% confidence interval. And okay, it says using the result of first part, is it reasonable to believe that there is a 50-50 chance of the toast landing better butter side down or butter side up? So as you see, this confidence interval does not contain our hypothesized value. We didn't write it here, but our null hypothesis is again 0.5. And this doesn't contain, confidence interval doesn't contain this value, then you would say, okay, when you put a butter on one side of the bread, it will have higher probability of landing on that side. Okay, why do we erase the alternative hypothesis? Is the last binom test function. Because now we were, in this part, we were doing a two-tailed test. We were indicating a direction. Here, we are not indicating a direction. Okay, let's check if I said it wrong. Well, sometimes I get confused also for this part. So yes, I think I said it correct, right? So if you increase the confidence level, you would get a wider confidence interval. So when you think about it, this makes sense. If you want to truly catch the population parameter, then you would make your confidence interval wider. But of course, this will not be precise. Very wide confidence interval might not be informative. So going from 0.034 to 0.042. But if you make your confidence levels smaller, then so this means that 70% of the time your true population parameter will lie on that range. So this is like a trade-off, okay? So when you make it wider, your chances of catching the true population mean will be higher, but if you make it smaller, so like in this case, so in that case it means 70% of the time your population parameter will be in this range. So maybe I can show it to you from the previous week, but Etika made a good illustration about that, about confidence intervals, if I find it here. So yes, this part. So think of this graph like confidence interval. So so this is already confidence interval anyway. So like this is your true population mean. A very wide confidence interval will most of the time catch the true population mean, and narrow ones will also catch it, but with not always. So this puts it here, but sometimes it might be it might not contain this true population mean, okay? Okay, what else? So we already solved this question. So I think this was all for this week. So we will continue doing this webinar. If you have any question, I can answer it now. So do you think it is helpful? Okay, I will I will make this notes very detailed. I will add some explanations and then put it on OptiClass, so you don't need to watch the webinar again. You can look up the notes, and also for those who don't have internet connection, very stable internet connection, can read those notes. Okay, last question and quotes. Okay, I will update the lab manual. I will put it on OptiClass after this webinar. So this is the answer. So we have like 46 attendees. This is like half of the class. Assuming there is no one coming from not from our club. So this is good. We can continue doing like this if you think it's efficient. Okay, then I will stop the recording now. See you next week. Thanks.